Spring is a time of celebration in Cambridge Bay, Nunavut. For much of the year, life in this nearly 1,800-person Inuit community revolves around sea ice. But the Arctic is rapidly warming, and the ice is disappearing, forming later in the year and melting earlier than ever. Within the next few decades, or maybe even sooner, scientists predict that summers in the Arctic will be virtually ice-free. That spells huge changes for the planet and for the residents of Cambridge Bay. They're witnessing the effects firsthand, from fishing and hunting to increased risks when traveling between communities. They're also on the front lines of an effort to save the ice by drilling into the ocean. I'm Chloe Williams, a freelance journalist based in Yellowknife. In May, I headed up to Cambridge Bay with Gavin John, a photographer and videographer, to check out a bold experiment. About 7 kilometers outside of town, researchers from the UK company Real Ice were wrapping up their second winter of tests. Their big idea? To drill holes into the ice and pump seawater to the surface to make the sea ice thicker. If it's thick enough, it could stay frozen for longer and maybe even survive the summer. Real Ice says their goal is to ensure that sea ice remains in the Arctic year-round, giving humanity more time to adapt to and mitigate against climate change. And Cambridge Bay residents say thicker, longer-lasting ice could help preserve their traditions and ways of life. These testing grounds span the size of roughly 4 baseball stadiums, but the big dream is to refreeze 1 million square kilometers of the Arctic using underwater drones and hydrogen-powered pumps. In the Arctic, attempts to fix the climate, often proposed by outsiders, have the potential to put northern communities at disproportionate risk while attempting to solve a problem that largely isn't of their making. And some geoengineering proposals have faced backlash in recent years over their potential environmental and health impacts. But in Cambridge Bay, many people are supportive of the Real Ice project. That hasn't happened by chance. From the early stages of the project, Real Ice has sought to understand what Northerners think about ice thickening.
I think almost everybody's in agreement.
Jim McEachern is the chief administrative officer for the municipality of Cambridge Bay.
Anything that we can do to improve the safety and the ability for the Inuit to get on the land, anything we can do to improve that, the better, 100%.
Talia McSagic was born and raised in Cambridge Bay. When she first heard about the project, she told me the goal of saving sea ice immediately resonated.
I've experienced a lot of changes in the climate since in my 30 years.
As the executive director of the Kitikmeot Chamber of Commerce, she helped the Real Ice team organize consultations when they first started working in the community.
We used to see muskox right on the street and on like the roads and caribou, it was very close. And my children don't get to experience that because of how much it's changed.
Melting ice can impede animals' movements across the ice, including caribou's twice yearly migration to and from the mainland. Some animals have been known to break through thin ice and drown. Changes in the ice also put people at risk. Dangerous ice cracks show up in unexpected places, and in recent years, several people have fallen through thin ice. Henry Ohoilak, an elder in the community, echoed McSagic, saying he hopes future generations have the same opportunities he did.
I feel sorry for the generation to come.
Ohoilak grew up on the land until he was 14, living in tents or snow houses, depending on the season, and traveling by dog team.
What if we're gone and they want to do something for themselves? They don't know how to do it. Who's going to teach them?
Compared to other types of geoengineering, the technology itself is somewhat familiar to people. In Cambridge Bay, I spoke to Kian Sherwin, co-founder of Real Ice.
Well, I think the main reason for that is because it's not unfamiliar.
A similar approach is already used to build ice roads and skating rinks. Outside of Cambridge Bay, some scientists worry that pumping water on top of ice could alter the region's ecosystem. During a call with Mark Serez, director of the National Snow and Ice Data Center at the University of Colorado Boulder, he had this to say.
They're just band-aids. They're simply band-aids. Because if you do not address the core problem of rising carbon dioxide concentrations on methane, but basically mostly CO2 in the atmosphere, you would have to apply these band-aids more frequently and bigger band-aids, right?
There have also been serious doubts about the feasibility of scaling up to a meaningful extent. The project's ultimate goal, which would involve re-icing large swaths of the Arctic much further north than Cambridge Bay, would require an estimated 500,000 drones and cost $10 billion per year. But even if ice thickening were only ever used locally, Sherwin says he would be satisfied.
I would be, over the moon, even if this only made it to local scale. I would be super happy that we went down this route.
Some Cambridge Bay residents have raised concerns about possible impacts to wildlife. Brent Nakashuk, who's been working as a local guide for the Realize team, thinks the research is unlikely to cause environmental harm. The Nunavut Impact Review Board, through which the team applied for research permits, also concluded the work to date is unlikely to cause adverse environmental or social impacts. Sea ice thickening could be used to build a road to the mainland in winter, according to Nakashuk.
Well, I'm thinking seeing if you can thicken it from the bottom by flooding the top. That's something that's definitely interesting.
Already, a project has been proposed to build an all-season road from Yellowknife to Grays Bay at the edge of the Northwest Passage, just south of Victoria Island. An ice road across the passage could provide the final stretch. If negative effects arise, Nakashuk says the project will be required to stop.
And it's still interesting that somebody is giving it a shot to see where it can go.
Anything we can do to improve the overall climate, great. But the local impacts are the number one priority for me.